Violent crime, the physical act of harm against another person. Although violent crime largely drives the public's fear of crime and victimization, it is less common than many other types of crime. Let's start with the most obvious and heinous violent crime, homicide. Homicide is the killing of one person by another. It is the least common crime with the most serious penalties, including the death penalty in many places. It is also the crime with the most accurate statistics. Why is this? Well, the answer is obvious. A person died, and along with death comes tremendous implications. An extensive paper trail, including a death certificate, often an autopsy, storage and location of the body, funeral arrangements, including grieving loved ones, an estate, which involves dealing with assets and obligations, and much more. So, for these reasons, crime statistics for homicide are the most accurate we have. There are many different types of homicides. Homicide charges range from the most serious murders involving premeditation and deliberate action to the least serious manslaughter charges when a death occurs as a result of someone's action or inaction, but is unplanned and unintentional. Looking specifically at murder, some offenders kill people they know, either acquaintances or intimate partners. Intimate partner murders account for approximately 40% of murders involving females either as an offender or victim. About 20% of murders are between strangers. There are also sexually based murders, where the victim is killed in relation to a rape or sexual assault. And then there are offenders who kill multiple people, serial, mass, and spree murderers. A serial murderer kills three or more people in three or more separate events. A mass murderer kills numerous victims all at the same time, sometimes for revenge, sometimes for love gone wrong, sometimes for a religious or political motive as in a terrorist attack, or for profit. And a spree murderer kills multiple victims over a relatively short span of time, often with no discernible pattern. With the exception of homicides committed unexpectedly in the heat of the moment based on unique circumstances that are unlikely to be replicated, often referred to as crimes of passion, many murderers tend to have long criminal careers. This does not necessarily mean they are committing more murders, but they tend to commit other crimes as well. Now let's look at assault, which involves non-lethal physical harm against another person. This is the most common form of violent crime. There are two different categories of general assault, simple and aggravated. The difference between the two depends on two factors, the severity of injuries to the victim and whether or not a weapon was used. If a weapon was used and or the victim was severely injured, it's an aggravated assault. If there was no weapon and there were only minor or no injuries, it's a simple assault. Assault can occur between strangers, acquaintances, or in intimate partner relationships, such as in cases of domestic violence. Unfortunately, when people spend more time together, the likelihood for abusive situations to develop increases. It can be extraordinarily difficult for many victims to escape these situations, as their whole life has become intertwined with their partners. The offending partner may also have spent a great deal of time degrading the victim's sense of self-worth, making them feel like they can't survive if they leave. Others are directly threatened with violence if they leave, either against them or another loved one. And of course, domestic violence is even more complicated and tragic when there are children involved. Domestic violence has only gotten worse with the pandemic, as being quarantined together for months on end with nowhere to go and being cut off from usual support networks has only made these hellish situations even more suffocating for so many victims. Another type of assault is the abuse of children and the elderly. Both are vulnerable populations, too often subjected to physical and/or sexual abuse, but also emotional abuse and neglect. One specific type of assault that warrants its own category is rape and sexual assault. Rape is unwanted penile-vaginal sexual contact or penetration, while sexual assault is a more general term for all other forms of unwanted, non-consensual sexual contact, such as genital fondling, forced oral sex, or penetration by a foreign object. They can occur in many different settings. Intimate partner relationships? No, married people are not exempt from being an offender or victim. Potential dating relationships, also referred to as date rape, on college campuses, in the workplace, or other positions where there is a power differential between the offender and victim. And it's committed not as a purely sexual act, as once commonly thought, but as a coercive, aggressive act of violence committed by the offender to express anger or exert dominance over the victim. It also occurs when a victim is unable to give consent due to being disabled, mentally or physically, or intoxicated. Then there is statutory rape, where a victim is not legally able to consent due to age. The age of consent varies by state from 14 to 18, with the most common age being 16. Rape and sexual assault remain among the most misunderstood and underreported crimes. Then there is robbery, which involves the direct face-to-face theft of personal property through use of force or threats of force. Carjacking and purse snatching are two common examples. Victims are often convenient targets who appear to have something of value the offender either wants or could profit from selling. Robbery is often confused with burglary, which is a property offense where an offender enters a property to steal something. So, if an offender breaks into a house and steals something while the victim is not home, it is a burglary. If the victim happens to be home and gets into a confrontation with the offender who threatens the victim with harm if property is not handed over, then it becomes a robbery. So, the popular phrase, "I've been robbed," is often applied incorrectly. Next, we'll move from violent crimes to property crimes, sometimes referred to as blue-collar crimes. These are the most common criminal offenses, at least in terms of those tracked through official statistics. These are the index crimes in the UCR. Beginning with burglary, as just referenced and contrasting it with robbery, burglary involves entering a building or other physical space, such as a residence, a business, or a vehicle, with the intent of taking property without permission. Larceny is general basic theft, taking physical property or money without the use of force against the person, which, of course, if force were used, it would become a robbery. Larceny is the most common property crime. It could involve a small or large amount, stealing from an individual or business, such as cases of shoplifting, or receiving items that were stolen by somebody else. It could also involve stealing money from someone's bank account, taking someone's credit card, or writing someone a bad check. Another type of property crime is vandalism, the destruction or damage of a physical structure or building. The most serious type of vandalism is arson, the willful, malicious burning of a physical structure or building. Arson has many different causes. Some are psychological, emotional disturbance, a need to satisfy an urge to burn, such as with pyromania. Others are economic, setting fires for profit. Or others are looking to achieve a social or political objective, such as with environmental and animal rights extremists burning down buildings belonging to businesses. Next, let's look at public order crimes, also commonly referred to as victimless crimes, because they don't necessarily have an individual victim in the traditional sense, but the victim rather is thought to be society as a whole. These are behaviors outlawed because they are deemed to threaten the general well-being of society and challenge accepted moral principles. The most obvious examples are sex and drug crimes. Sex crimes here refers to any sex-related offense other than sexual assault and rape, which were covered earlier as violent crimes. One type of sex crime is paraphilia. Paraphilia is any kind of sexual practice deemed bizarre or abnormal. Examples include frotteurism, touching a non-consenting person in a public area, voyeurism, watching or spying on someone without their knowledge, exhibitionism, exposing oneself in public, sadomasochism, receiving or inflicting pain, and perhaps the most obvious, pedophilia, or sexual activity with prepubescent children. The latter is the most concerning, obviously, given that it involves exploiting children who are unable to consent, and it is closely tied to another sex crime, pornography, and more specifically, child pornography, sexually explicit material involving children. While pornography is generally legal, or at the very least, any prohibitions or restrictions are rarely enforced, child pornography is another matter due to the exploitation of children. Then there's prostitution, non-emotional, non-marital sex for money or some other kind of economic benefit. Prostitution is illegal across the U.S., except for Nevada, but enforcement is inconsistent. Arguably, the biggest concerns with prostitution come from exploitation and dangers of victimization faced by sex workers. They are often the victims of physical and/or sexual violence, along with theft. And prostitution is closely related with concerns over human trafficking, particularly sex trafficking, the victims of which, all too often, are children and young women. Next, there are drug crimes. Many drugs are outlawed in the U.S., both due to the harm they cause to those who take them, but also due to their links with other types of crime. Drug and alcohol use are heavily linked to engagement in more serious criminal offenses. Alcohol, for instance, has been linked to upwards of 40% of all violent crimes, but yet it remains legal for those over the age of 21. So why not make it illegal? Well, we tried this once in the early 20th century during the Prohibition era, and it didn't work out so well. So it was legalized again, but heavily regulated. The same argument has been made in regard to the merits of legalizing other drugs. And we've seen some of this reversal when it comes to marijuana decriminalization. While drugs and crime are inherently linked, the nature of their relationship isn't quite so straightforward. Namely, one may or may not cause the other. It may be that both share the same root cause, such as impulsive behavior. Or perhaps crime is caused by a need to finance a drug habit. Or criminal activity could cause increased exposure exposure to drugs, thereby increasing the chances of drug usage. To the end of stamping out drugs and crime, hundreds of billions of dollars have been spent on the so-called war on drugs, but any positive impact is sketchy at best. And critics would argue the solution is worse than the problem it's intended to solve, particularly when we look at the number of people who have been incarcerated for drug-related offenses and the impact this has had on families and communities. And now, more people die each year from abusing legal prescription drugs, such as opioids, than abusing illegal drugs. Another type of offense that could be put in its own category, but also fits under public order, are status offenses. This is most commonly associated with juveniles. Truancy, not going to school, smoking, consuming alcohol, or running away from home. All of these are behaviors illegal for juveniles due to their status as a juvenile. They would not be illegal if an adult did them. Other examples of status offenses could be violating conditions placed on a person who is convicted of a crime, such as laws prohibiting felons from carrying firearms. Or for more despicable examples from our past, we can look to laws enforcing segregation and slavery. Now let's turn toward another crime type commonly referred to as white-collar crime. The term white-collar crime was originally coined to distinguish and highlight crimes committed by a person of respectability and high social status in the course of his or her occupation. Those who commit white-collar crime are distinctive in several ways. They tend to be middle-aged, white, college-educated, and have a higher socioeconomic status. It has also been used to refer to specific types of offenses as opposed to concentrating on the social status of the offender. So white-collar crime has taken many different forms. Dangerous workplaces and consumer products, environmental crimes, also sometimes referred to as green-collar crimes, embezzlement, bribery and corruption, economic espionage, fraud, financial crime, insider trading, antitrust violations, employee theft, and tax avoidance, just to name a few. While terms used to describe white-collar crimes vary widely and have evolved over time, there's no universal agreement. One distinction is between crimes committed by individual and organizational actors. Occupational crimes refer to crimes perpetrated during the course of a person's legitimate occupation. This is typically carried out by leveraging access within an organization and/or a status as a trusted professional for personal gain at the expense of the organization itself. Occupational crime could be committed by employees, managers, or executives in various types of organizations, from small businesses to large corporations, as well as in government and nonprofit organizations. For example, occupational crime could be an individual who steals money or supplies from their employer, or an executive who loots a company to line their own pockets. In contrast to the individual focus of occupational crimes, organizational crimes refer to crime committed by an organization itself. This is done through the collective actions of individuals within that organization who make conscious decisions to engage in socially harmful acts to further their own goals and those of the organization as a whole. Perhaps the most well-known organizational crime is corporate crime. Like white-collar crime, it has many definitions, but one I like to use includes socially injurious and blameworthy acts, legal or illegal, that cause financial, physical, or environmental harm committed by corporations and businesses against their workers, the general public, the environment, other corporations or businesses, the government, or other countries. The number and types of victims of white-collar crime are far-reaching. A single crime could potentially impact thousands, if not millions, of people. White-collar crime causes massive financial damage, costing consumers, taxpayers, investors, etc., hundreds of millions of dollars each year, and that's a low-end estimate. For major cases, the losses could be in the hundreds of billions of dollars. But white-collar crime is not strictly financial. It could also lead to physical injury and death. Consider the number of potential victims when an unsafe product is put out onto the market, such as with the Dalcon Shield, the Ford Pinto, or with adulterated, contaminated, or falsely labeled food, or when workers are placed in dangerous conditions, as with the Imperial Foods case, where 25 workers were killed and 56 more were injured when the plant they were working in caught on fire and they were unable to escape because the doors had been locked to keep out flies, or the lead poisoning of the residents of Flint, Michigan, making countless people sick and leaving a whole generation of children with potentially lifelong, irreversible brain damage, or the explosion of the Deepwater Horizon, which killed 11 people and then dumped nearly 5 million barrels worth of oil into the Gulf of Mexico, severely damaging the local ecosystem. And these are just a few examples. And there's much that remains that we don't know about the true extent of the impacts and costs of white-collar crime. Speaking of crimes more extensive than we truly have a grasp on, we'll turn now to political crimes. Political crimes are acts designed to undermine an existing government and threaten its survival. They include a wide array of behaviors. One is corruption, a breach of public trust and or abuse of position by government officials and private sector accomplices. This is often done by using their position to illicitly gain or hold on to money and power. Closely related is state corporate crime, where public and private actors coordinate together for some type of illicit gain or perpetrate some type of social harm against the public. Some political crimes are acts of state violence committed by state actors against non-state actors or civilians. An example is the use of torture, intentionally inflicting harm, physical or mental, to obtain information, punish, intimidate, or coerce a person into doing something, such as confessing to a crime. Another example could be the unlawful use of force by police officers against citizens, such as unjustified shootings or excessive force to subdue a subject or control a crowd, or when a person is wrongfully imprisoned and has their liberty taken away without probable cause or due process. Next, there is espionage, more commonly referred to as spying. This is when an individual or government obtains secret or confidential information without the holder's permission. Governments are engaged in espionage against one another all the time. It's just referred to by a different name, intelligence. But if a spy is caught by another country, they can be punished by that nation's criminal justice system unless some type of diplomatic solution can be reached. And within countries, espionage can cross the line into illegal surveillance or gathering information on citizens. And it isn't restricted to state actors. Industrial espionage is carried out by and against companies to try to get information that can be sold, used for some other strategic competitive advantage, or for sabotage. Next, we'll look at election fraud, which involves illegal interference with the political process, intimidating or even physically preventing voters from casting their ballots, registering people ineligible to vote, creating fake ballots, deliberately giving out false information about voting dates or procedures, or offering direct payments in exchange for votes. Although much has been made about voter fraud in the U.S., actual verified cases of individuals attempting to vote illegally are very rare, and there is a simple reason for this. People don't vote. Now, of course, I'm broad brushing here. People obviously vote. But even in high turnout elections, like the recent 2020 elections with a record number of people voting, still only about two-thirds of eligible voters cast a ballot. And this is the highest level we've seen. Usually it's closer to half. So, why are you going to go out of your way to break the law to do something you don't feel like doing in the first place? It's much more likely that election fraud occurs not by individual voters, but by state actors and political parties aiming to manipulate the vote to either maintain or obtain power. After all, trying to rig an election at the individual level just isn't going to work. It's not very efficient. You're not going to have that much of an impact, and you're likely to get caught. It's a much more efficient and effective strategy to pass laws and file lawsuits to try to prevent people from voting or to throw out votes cast by people who aren't likely to vote in your favor. Immigration offenses could also fit in here as political crimes. Immigration offenses typically involve illegally entering a country by a non-citizen or aiding someone in doing so, such as smuggling them in, or remaining past the legally permitted time allowed, such as overstaying a visa. It could also involve fraud, such as making false statements to obtain a visa, passport, or citizenship. And then there are political crimes against the institution of the government itself, treason, sedition, and insurrection. This has received renewed interest lately, and there's a lot of confusion among these crimes. In the U.S. context, they all have slightly different meanings. Treason is one of only three crimes specifically and narrowly defined in the U.S. Constitution. The other two are maritime piracy and counterfeiting U.S. currency. Treason centers on conspiracies by groups of citizens to levy war against the government or aiding its declared enemies in times of war. For example, several people were charged with treason for defecting to Nazi Germany during World War II. Treason is commonly discussed casually, but rarely ever used. Only a few dozen people in U.S. history have ever formally been charged with treason. Sedition and insurrection, on the other hand, have broader applications. Sedition is an organized conspiracy to use force to overthrow or wage war against the government, oppose government authority, or prevent the execution of U.S. laws, or take over U.S. property. And insurrection is the most vaguely defined, but centers on open rebellion against the government. A related law authorizes the president to call on the National Guard to disperse and suppress an insurrection. And then there's terrorism, which, like the general concept of crime, is very much open to subjective interpretation. Much of what falls under the broad terrorism umbrella is not considered a crime, or at least not a crime by law that's on the books. Much of it may not even be considered by many to be terrorism. Here's what I mean. Is killing a black person based solely on the fact that person was black an act of terrorism? Is burning down a business to stop them from cutting down trees with the aim of protecting the environment an act of terrorism? Was the January 6th storming of the U.S. Capitol building to overturn the results of a presidential election and keep the person who lost in power an act of terrorism? There is no commonly agreed upon definition of terrorism. Over 100 such definitions exist, including several different definitions used among U.S. government agencies. Different individuals and groups in society help to shape our shared conceptions of terrorism. Our ideas about the terrorist threat vary widely depending on our own perspectives, backgrounds, and experiences. To illustrate, there is a famous phrase, "One person's terrorist is another's freedom fighter." Under what circumstances is a person a terrorist as opposed to a freedom fighter? And who makes that determination? And when? All of this context matters. Consider that the very same people who were considered freedom fighters by the U.S. when they were fighting against the Soviet Union in Afghanistan later comprised the terrorist group known as Al-Qaeda. And what about acts of oppressive force committed by a state to stifle dissent? This could be considered state-sponsored terrorism. But what about when the state defines anyone who opposes them as terrorists? For example, in the conflict in Syria, Syrian President Bashar al-Assad has designated those who are fighting against his government as terrorists. Many others, including U.S. government officials, consider them to be freedom fighters. That said, while definitions of terrorism vary widely, most require that terrorism is perpetuated by one or more offenders who have a social, political, or religious objective. In other words, an extremist ideology. Extremism speaks to a mindset, a belief, a value system, an ideology, and something that is far outside conventional social, political, or religious beliefs. White supremacists, anti-government, Islamic jihadists, anarchists, environmental and animal rights extremists. Those who engage in acts of violence or other crime based on this extreme ideological belief then become terrorists. And it's not restricted to acts by formally recognized terrorist organizations, such as ISIL. It can involve smaller groups of individuals or cells, or individuals acting alone, such as in the cases of lone wolf terrorism. What matters is the belief the extremist ideology is combined with the behavior, an act of crime or violence, to further that belief. And terrorists are involved in all sorts of crime. Murder is obvious, but also fraud, forgery, identity theft, human trafficking, money laundering, extortion, burglary, robbery, kidnapping, smuggling illicit goods, just to name a few. This highlights the continuum between terrorism and crime. Where does one begin and the other end? The answer is not quite so straightforward. Terrorist groups become involved in criminal activities, and organized crime groups engage in terrorist tactics. There are numerous variations along the terror-crime continuum. This brings us to transnational organized crime. This involves criminals operating together in some kind of organized and sustained manner across national borders. It's being lumped in together here with more traditional organized crime groups and street gangs because they really aren't much different from one another. The only major difference is whether their activities are confined to a more local area like a neighborhood or whether they operate across borders. They still tend to commit similar types of crimes, exploiting whatever criminal opportunities are available to them for profit. The key is that it involves a criminal enterprise of some kind where people work together over a period of time to commit crimes and share their illicit profits. Common transnational organized criminal activity includes trafficking illicit drugs and other goods and human trafficking, selling people, especially for sex or labor. Transnational organized crime has also been aided by the availability of the internet that affords them the ability to communicate, coordinate operations, and carry out profit-oriented crimes. With that, we'll now conclude by looking at cybercrime. Cybercrime is the theft and/or destruction of information, resources, or funds via computers, computer networks, or the internet. The scale and scope of cybercrime is largely unknown because it often goes unreported by both individuals and businesses, many of whom may not even know they have been victimized. There are three general types of cybercrime: cyber theft, cyber vandalism, and cyber war or cyber terrorism. Cyber theft involves using the internet to distribute illegal goods and services, which we just discussed, or to defraud people for profit. There are numerous examples: identity theft, stealing a person's personal information to, in their name, do things like open bank accounts or lines of credit, make purchases, or steal tax refunds. Phishing scams, tricking people into thinking a website or email is legitimate to steal their information. Fraudulent securities, manipulating securities markets. And advance fee, or what is commonly referred to as a Nigerian letter scam, send money to cover costs of claiming a massive fortune. And of course, there are countless other types of thefts that occur online. Cyber vandalism involves using the internet for revenge, destruction, or other malicious intentions, aside from strictly profit. Website defacement is when a hacker accesses the victim's website and enters misleading or damaging information. Worms are self-replicating codes that secretly embed in computers and their networks and send themselves to other users without the aid of the operator. Viruses disrupt and destroy existing programs and networks. Trojan horses look like benign applications but contain illicit codes that can damage the computer system's operations. These damaging codes and programs often come through spam, unsolicited email and electronic communications, linking to an infected website, or downloading an infected file. And then there are cyberstalking and cyberbullying, which, as the names imply, involves stalking and bullying through the internet. Cyberstalking can occur through unwanted emails, contacts in chat rooms, forums, and social media platforms. Sometimes the purpose is to lure victims into initiating a relationship, sexual or otherwise, or sharing personal information that can be used to harm them in some way. Cyberbullying is deliberately inflicting harm on a person through the internet. Bullying has tremendous short and long-term impacts on victims, and cyberbullying is no different. And just because there is a physical separation doesn't make the bullying any less real. In many cases, it can be even more harmful. Once something is posted online, it is there for the whole world to see. Nude pictures are an obvious example. A physical copy of a nude picture can be shared, but the range is limited. A nude picture posted online can be seen instantaneously by anyone in the world and can live online forever. Even in the unlikely scenario where it is taken down or scrubbed from most websites, it can still exist somewhere in the deep web, part of the internet hidden from normal channels and not accessible through traditional search engines. And you'll never have any idea how many people downloaded and saved a copy on a local hard drive. Sensitive or untrue information posted online can follow that person for the rest of his or her life. Cyberbullying is a major problem for all ages, but seems to be especially prolific among juveniles. And finally, cyber war involves efforts to disrupt the intersection where the virtual electronic reality of the internet meets the physical world, such as hacking into and shutting down critical systems or networks. Cyber war is happening all the time, every day, with independent hackers and state actors, hackers working on behalf of a national government, trying to access critical systems, either for profit or to obtain critical information that can later be used to their advantage. Cyberterrorism is similar, but specifically committed to intimidate or coerce a government or its people for social, political, or religious objectives, to generate fear, or disrupt essential services. Cyberterrorism can come in the form of these attacks on critical systems, but these attempts have largely been unsuccessful. This does not mean terrorism has not intersected with the internet, though. Quite the contrary. Terrorism, hate, and extremism have flourished online. Terrorists use the internet for fundraising, recruitment, and communications. They also use it to engage in cyber theft and cyber vandalism, and they use it to access and cultivate a broader base of support by spreading and sustaining extremist ideas and misinformation.